Remember those walls that we call sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we called death and grave. They were like mountains that stood in our way. But he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does, he saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Now those altars in the wilderness tell the story of his faithfulness. Never once did he fail, and he never will. This is our God, this is who he is, he loves us. This is our God, this is what he does, he saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave, let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did. He did. Who paid for all of our sin? Nobody but Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did. He did. Who paid for all of our sin? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but him. This is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus. Before the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live.
Outside of the room or also in our connection area, there is a gift we'll have for you. We love to give some gifts, some sweet treats to Legendary, so just if you fill that out for us, that'd be great. Also, here in a minute, we're going to take time to take communion. So if you didn't get a chance to grab a communion cup, you can go ahead and do that just right now. But before that, I've got a couple announcements, and I want to thank you all for Friday night. I don't know if you got a chance to come out, but man, I was so impressed with how many of you came out. I think we had somewhere between 150 and 200. We served 130 main dishes is what they counted up. And so it was just awesome to be out here. Want to thank Jet Dress. They did an awesome job, amen? Yeah, and Rebecca Lawson. But thank you all to the volunteers. It was a great night of celebration. Thank you for helping put everything together. And so we just want to say thanks. We have Vacation Bible School coming up, not this Monday, but the following week. We want to make sure that you're here and part of that. Get signed up today if you haven't already. If you want to help out, I'm sure Beth will find a spot for you, and we're excited about that. This is really important. We have been repainting the Student Center, and if you don't know that, and you are a really good painter, we would appreciate you, all right? So, and that you can see is July 8th and noon, until noon. We'll have lunch for you. I'm going to smoke some barbecue, if that helps. Maybe it doesn't, I don't know. So, but we'll smoke some barbecue. I'll have some barbecue and donuts for the morning. But this is another really, really important. We've got a few people going to Brazil for a mission trip. And if you want to help them out, really, not just them, but those folks in Brazil, bring in some medicine. I know that in my time used on mission trips, you know, you just don't know what that means to the people. So vitamins, medicine, if you want to know more, see them about that. But we would really appreciate that. At this time, I want to go into our time of communion. And just a little bit ago, I read this passage, and, you know, Mike is talking about kingdom and Christ's kingdom and really what that means. And we have all kinds of things in our life that are just vowing for attention every day. And maybe for some of us, they become those little kingdoms. And I just want to say, I just want to read this again from Revelation 5:12. It says, in a loud voice, they were saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and glory and praise. But worthy was him who was slain. And so every Sunday when we come in here, we take this time, we take that cup, and we commune together, the breaking of the bread that represents his body. So if you would take that cup right now. And just take the time to reflect that he truly is worthy because of his body that was broken for us. He's truly worthy of our worship because of his blood that was poured out for us. Father, as we just take this time to reflect and worship you, Lord, that you truly are worthy. Worthy of our praise because that you were slain for us. That you willingly laid down your life to forgive us. And God, we thank you. It's in Christ's name that we pray.
Nothing worth more. glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence. Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence,
to it. Thank you. Happy Father's Day, 3C.
Happy Father's Day.
Good. Is it easier to say good morning? Okay. All right, there we go. Well, good morning.
Morning.
All right, there we go. That's cool. Happy Father's Day. Hey, I hear that Chick-fil-A is honoring all fathers by giving away a free meal all normal business hours today. So you dads are welcome to partake in that. So happy Father's Day. Hey, I don't know how many of you, especially you dads, but include the ladies in here as well, and those of us who aren't parents. But I don't know how many of you are notorious for having to learn the lessons of life the hard way. All right? I don't need any show of hands or anything like that, right? I think we all know who that is in the room. No, I'm just kidding. But, you know, we're notorious for, at times, we all have had to learn things the hard way. And while, you know, philosophically, we'd love to learn things the easy way, and sometimes we do. But really what we mean when we say the hard way versus easy way, the hard way is when we have to learn life's lessons through our own experience, right? And the hard part about that, the reason it's hard, is because sometimes and most times the lessons are hard lessons and hard experiences. And so if the easy way is learning from others, right? The easy way is learning from others' mistakes or others' wisdom, how they got things right or when they got things wrong. We just listen to their experience and hear about their experience and learn from it and apply it to our lives. But some of us, we got to learn the hard way. We got to learn on our own and through our own experience. A few weeks ago, we kicked off this series called The King and Kingdom. And we called it The King and Kingdom because we're examining stories Jesus tells about God's kingdom. And in other words, it is meant to be an insight into the way things, the way God wants things to be. And some of us have to learn the hard way to learn it, these lessons ourselves, but these stories are a great way to discover truth about this world and the way things are supposed to be and the way things are. But sometimes we have to learn it the hard way, but these stories are a great way to understand discovering these truths and learning it the easy way. This is why Jesus' favorite teaching method is through stories, which is what we're looking at, these stories that Jesus told that gives us insight into his kingdom. A good example of these stories can be found in Mark 4, and we're going to be in Mark 4 today. If you want to turn, if you got your Bibles, you can turn there. Then we're going to have the scriptures I'm going to read up on the screen, but I would encourage you to read Mark 4 this week. And in fact, over the next few weeks, today we're going to be in Mark 4. Over the next several weeks, we're going to look at Matthew 13, which there have a lot of similarities. But because inside of these few chapters are a bunch of short stories, Jesus tells. They're filled and packed with varying insights that Jesus tells about through parables about his kingdom and about the kingdom of God. And these little stories remind me of tapas. Anybody know what tapas is? It's tapas is a kind of a small plate approach to a meal. So my wife and I went to a restaurant that my daughter's going to work out this summer when she comes home, called Mita's. It's downtown. We, on our anniversary, we always try to go somewhere we haven't been before, or this sort of thing. No holds bar on the price. We want to celebrate that day. And we went to this place and had all these small plates. Now, I've been to these places before with my dad or somebody, and he grumbles and complains, you know, because you pay the same price and it's just a different size portion, you know, that sort of thing. It's pretty much true. But it is really more of an approach to meals where you're getting smaller portions, which, let's be honest, we could use. I mean, at least this guy could use. But it's this idea that you're filling up, but you get a variety of different stuff. You get all kinds of different stuff that they keep bringing. And so what Jesus does, and what Mark and Matthew record in Mark chapter 4 and Matthew chapter 13, which Matthew 13 is what we're going to spend most of our time in the rest of the series in, just picking apart the stories Jesus tells in that chapter. But they're like little topics. They're little stories packed in there in these few little chapters. And so we want to look at those stories, and we want to take them more in depth. And like I said, we'll look at Matthew 13 the next few weeks, but today we're going to be in Mark 4. Today our focus is on Mark chapter 4. And the reason I brought up the topic is because this is the style that Jesus is using. It's a bunch of short stories, parables about the kingdom of God. So I encourage you to read Mark 4, which we're going to be in today, and Matthew 13 the next few weeks. But we're going to look at Mark 4 today. We're going to start in verse 11. If you have your Bibles, this is where we go. If you look at one verse earlier, he tells them, it's his disciples, and he's pulling them aside. But he addresses these disciples in verse 11, and he's told them, he says, "The secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you. But to those on the outside, everything is said in parables, so that," and then he quotes a scripture from the Old Testament, from Isaiah, "they may ever be seeing but never perceiving, and ever hearing but never understanding, and otherwise they might turn and be forgiven." As we spend time in this series, The King and the Kingdom, this is a very important passage. In fact, I fully came into this study of this week picking a different section of Mark 4. And then when I saw this, I just couldn't help but spend my time today focusing on these few verses, because it reveals a major truth, a truth maybe you have wrestled with before if you've spent any time reading the scripture, because Jesus talks about the kingdom a lot, and he uses languages sometimes that are a little mysterious and maybe even confusing to us. And here, he even says that the secret is yours, has been given to you. And the secret of the kingdom of God. And we're like, well, what's the secret, right? What is the secret? I don't see him like explain it to them or say it to them. But the secret that is given to them, because Jesus talks about the kingdom being at hand, talks about the kingdom has come, the kingdom is coming, the kingdom is here. And we're like, okay, what is he talking about? And you got to put yourselves in the shoes of Jesus' listeners, but listen to this. The secret to the kingdom of God that Jesus is talking about is simply this, that Jesus is king. Now, that may seem obvious to us 2,000 years later, but this was not obvious back then. The people that were listening to Jesus tell these stories, the people that were hearing these teachings and trying to decipher what they meant, they are largely Israelites who have waited generation after generation. They have seen their people endure hundreds and centuries of captivity by pagan nation after pagan nation, handing one like a baton to another, that they would exist under the oppression of these nations. They had waited for a king who would come and rescue them from this oppression, that they have suffered persecution and oppression, waiting for this Messiah that all these Old Testament prophets from old had promised, that God had promised through them. And in fact, they had sat through 400 years where God hadn't seemed to speak at all. And it seemed like he had kind of given up on his country. They were waiting for a Messiah. They were waiting for a Savior. They were waiting for this one true King. Not to mention the people that were listening to Jesus, that were a part of his people, but that were staunch and stood in staunch opposition, waiting for him to trip up on his words so that they could get him in trouble with the law. Not to mention either Rome and Caesar, right, who was ruling the land at this time, who really don't take too kindly to anyone else calling themselves king. Put yourself in the shoes of any of Jesus' listeners when he's saying these words, especially his disciples. The secret to the kingdom of God may seem a little obvious to us, but I would suggest it may not be. But the secret is simply this, that Jesus is king. Now granted, he's a veiled king. He's not a king that's obvious yet. He's not wearing a crown. He doesn't have a throne that he's sitting on. There's been no coronation service. It's not obvious to everyone yet. But that's why this is a little bit of a secret. But it's not a secret to everyone. And this is why he tells them the secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you. The king is able to tell them about the kingdom. So it's one thing to listen inside of a kingdom to a noble speak about kingdom, to a prince or a princess. It's one thing to speak to the court jester or any other characters that you would imagine that is present in a kingdom. But Jesus is reminding his disciples without coming right out and saying it in the scripture. Instead, he tells stories and parables that gives them insight into the king and to the kingdom. And this is key. The secret is key. You know why? Because knowing who the king is really all that matters in a kingdom. Knowing the king is all that you need to know when it comes to the kingdom, because then you know who to listen to. You know who to take direction from. You know who to obey. And then when the king speaks, you realize something more about the way the kingdom is supposed to operate. He is the authority. He is the only authority. And so when the king speaks, he speaks with authority over the kingdom. And so knowing who the king is, the secret, gives them great insight on what the kingdom is supposed to be like. When you know the king, you know the kingdom. Have you ever been in one of those situations, though, you didn't really appreciate who you were in the presence of? You didn't really know who they were, or maybe, you know, that sort of thing, whether it was somebody in a position of authority or somebody's relative that was connected. You didn't know the little small world. I mean, there's been times where, you know, my kids are adults now, so you don't really see them around church all the time, when somebody realized, oh, you're Mike and Tony's kid. They you know, feel that, and they're like shrinking inside, trying to get away. Yeah, Mike and Tony's kid, right? That's what they're known as, right? Mike's kid. My dad was in a situation like this, though. It was a little different. He used to work at the Cincinnati Inquirer, and he was escorting two prominent guests that the Inquirer had welcomed into the town and city. And it was Chris Rock, the comedian, and Bono, the rock star, the lead singer for U2. I don't know if you know these guys or not, but my dad escorted them from the garage and up the elevator to where they were going. And on the elevator ride up, Dad looked at Chris Rock and said, "Man, love your comedy. Think it's great, man. Thank you. Yeah, it's awesome." And Chris is standing there, and Bono is standing right next to him. And he goes, "What about him?" And Dad goes, "Who?" "Him." "And who's he?" "That's Bono. Never heard of him." And if you know my dad, it's just a matter of fact, never heard of him. And Chris Rock says, "You mean the lead singer for U2? He says, "Never heard of them." And so it was an awkward pause for about 5 seconds with the three of them, and then they just kind of busted out laughing between the three of them. It was like, it was a great moment. Here is honestly one of the biggest rock bands over the last several decades, and my dad had no clue who this guy was. And to Bono's credit, he laughed it off and rolled with it. Didn't seem like any big deal at all. But here's the thing, the key to knowing about God's kingdom. See, it's important to know who you're in the presence of, because then you know a little bit about your situation. But the key to knowing about the kingdom of God is knowing the King. And once you know who Jesus is, once you acknowledge that this is the King, once you recognize, oh, this is King Jesus, then your relationship is a little different. You listen a little different. You take direction about the kingdom a little different. You see, in Matthew's account of this story, Matthew 13, Jesus describes it this way. He says, the prophets and the righteous people long to see what you see and did not see it. They long to hear what you hear but did not hear it. He is saying that generation after generation of Israelite people have longed to see this moment in history where the King shows up. God used prophets to predict the coming Messiah, the chosen one's coming, but they never got to see it. Prophets of old longed to have the salvation the Messiah would bring, prayed and begged God that they would be able to see him in their lifetime. And Jesus is telling his audience and us that they have access to the King. And Jesus says, the secret of the kingdom has been given to you. Not everyone knows who the King is. And let's not take that for granted, 3C. Not everybody acknowledges who the true King is. But you know, you are in on the secret. You know exactly who to take direction from and who to listen to and who to follow. You know who the King is. And what's cool and that we don't appreciate about that, they knew they got to be in the presence with the King. They knew who the King is, and the truth is we do too. And so when the King starts talking about the kingdom, we listen. So with that said, Jesus moves on. In verse 12, he says this. He says, but to those on the outside, everything is said in parables so that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving and ever hearing but never understanding. Otherwise, they might turn and be forgiven. As I mentioned, Jesus is quoting from an Old Testament prophet named Isaiah. And Jesus uses this quote a number of times throughout his ministry. It's a line that really should serve as alarm bells for us as Christians, for our faith. That he quotes this Old Testament prophet and quotes him often because Israel had a history of not listening to God. Right? They had eyes, but they didn't see. They had ears, but they didn't listen. And if you read the history of the Old Testament, you see that their cycle repeats itself, that Israel would get themselves in trouble. They would beg God for a rescue of some kind, and they would promise to obey if they just got him out of trouble this one time, right? We've never had those prayers before ourselves, right? But God would, in his mercy and grace, bail them out and rescue them, only for Israel to a few years later to repeat the whole thing over and over again. And if you read the Old Testament, it is just one cycle after another of that story. And Israel's problem, the reason they repeated this cycle, Israel didn't treat God as king. They wanted to be a king. They wanted to have a king over their own kingdom. They wanted to rule. They wanted to kind of choose their ways instead of trusting in God's ways, which is why they got into this cycle of sin and trouble and asking for help and God rescue them and only for them to go into sin again. And despite God proving himself to be a good king, rescuing them over and over again, they never chose to submit and recognize the one and only King. See, the problem was Israel back then didn't treat God as king. They didn't listen and obey. They didn't operate the kingdom as the king commanded. And our problem, oftentimes, is that we don't treat or see Jesus as king. We see him as a friend. We see him as a savior. But we don't see him as king, humbly submitting to the king. And we can sit back and be super judgmental of Israel and their lack of repentance and lack of faith in the history of events. We can read those stories and say, like, we'd be much more faithful, we'd be much more obedient to God's commands. And if we had the chance in their situation, we'd have done better. And I don't want to overwhelm you with guilt or anything, but this is exactly why there's grace. But like Israel, we, and I mean me and you, need to know that God is not just a rich daddy who bails us out when we're suffering. God is a good king who calls us to surrender everything. See, now's not the time to be critical about Israel's history. It's not a time to examine their behavior and be super harsh on them and critique how they messed up. This is a time to examine our own hearts, our own life, examine the cross and how we submit to the king, and ask this question: is Jesus king of my life? Is he ruler? Is he reigning as my king? And not just parts of my life, my entire life, every area of life. Is Jesus king of my heart and my emotions? Is Jesus king of my thoughts and my finances? Is Jesus king of my entertainment thoughts? Is he king of the words that come out of my mouth? Do I trust him as king to rule over my physical health and my physical well-being? Is Jesus king of my schedule? Is Jesus king of my weekends? Is Jesus king of my relationships? Is Jesus king at work? Is Jesus king of my attitude? What do you need to surrender to the king? Like in the Old Testament, it's a matter of trust, trusting in your reign or trusting God to reign in your life. And we're never going to be perfect at this. Again, I don't mean to cast guilt. I want to shed light on, are we recognizing Jesus as our king, or are we king and he's just our advisor? He's just our wise counsel. Or is he king and we're doing what he says? Jesus is saying that if I'm your king, you'll trust me and you'll listen. You'll understand me and obey. See, that we hear things sometimes, we don't want to listen. We get to observe things, we don't want to really see them. See, if you're never discovering something new about how God is directing you or what God is nudging you into, you might want to question how well you're listening for the king's direction. He says, listen in this scripture because he's the king. And the Lord deserves our attention. And if he's the king, we should humbly be waiting on his word, whether it's big or small, just like you would do with a real earthly king. The good news is that he's a good king. He's not an abusive king. He's not a selfish king. He's a king with good motives and has our best interests. He tells us to understand, to spend time examining, spend time on what the meaning is for us, wrestling for what this his truths mean to us, which is partly why he tells these stories. And the last part is he just says, obey. Apply these teachings that I've given you. Put them into practice, trusting God's way above our own. See, James says this in chapter 4. He says, if you show me a faith without works, I'll show you a real faith that is full of works. It says faith without action, faith without obedience is dead. It's not a faith at all. So if we don't spend time considering what God is saying to us and listening and responding with obedience, we have to question our relationship with him. We have to question whether he is king of our life. So let the quote from Isaiah that Jesus references, the Old Testament prophet, be a warning and an alarm to us that if we're not obeying Jesus' teaching, he's not our king, at least in that area. And more important, a little twist on that statement is true. If we don't recognize Jesus as king, we're not going to obey his teachings. Is Jesus king of my life? That's the question. Is Jesus king of my entire life? In Mark chapter 4, later on in that chapter, we've been reading verses 11 and 12, but in verses 33 through 34, he says this, or Mark says this, excuse me. With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he was all alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. See, Jesus used parables to help his disciples discover the kingdom and the kingdom. And he uses those stories to help us discover the truths about him and his kingdom. That's what this whole series is all about. A look into the parables or the stories that Jesus tells us that give us insight into the king and to the kingdom. And the secret about all that is knowing who the king is and responding to him likewise. If he's the king, how do we respond? Last week I said, and I say this all the time, so it's not the last time you hear it, that truth is discovered, not downloaded. And one of the reasons I've learned to say this statement is because I believe Jesus tells us stories so that we can wrestle with the truths that he's saying, that we can just not just download something that we memorize and we can spit it out later. It is a wrestling with, it's a discovery process. And here's the truth I hope the message today is helping us discover. And that's this. Jesus is a good king who calls us to surrender everything. And to ask ourselves, though, is Jesus Lord of my entire life? Not just part. You're not allowed to just say, hey, king, I'm just going to keep this section. I'm going to rule and reign here. You can have Sunday. You can have certain parts of my life, but I'm going to keep this one here because I really like having control here. No, there's a humility in this relationship where we're bowing and handing everything over. The secret is knowing who the king is and treating him as such as the king. Jesus is the secret to this kingdom. He's the key. This is the key to life. If you believe this, you operate your whole life around your faith in this one truth that Jesus is the king. And if you surrender to the king, it's not just part of your life, but it's every aspect of who you are, and you give it over to the king. If you do this, you will have discovered what every generation prior to Jesus and every generation that has ever walked the face of the earth has been searching for. You will have discovered what the history of the world has been asking, basic questions about life and meaning and purpose. You will have found what every prophet in Old Testament scripture has longed to hear and see. You will have discovered from the king himself what every child of God longs to know. You will have found what every human longs to find. You will have found your identity and your purpose when you discover that Jesus is king. When you trust the king, you then discover who you are and what you're meant to do. And you begin a road to a fulfilled life. You are a designated, set apart representative of the one true king, and you are called to be an ambassador of his kingdom to this world and this kingdom. This is what you discover when you settle in to the idea that Jesus is King. And all the benefits of your life is directed. I was talking to a young woman who I got to baptize. I had the privilege of baptizing this past Thursday. Her name's Jamie. I think she'll be here second service. I don't think she's here this service. But we were talking, and she was like, we were talking. It was like, you know how you've been in those caves where you can't see? It's so dark you can't see in front of your face, your hand in front of your face. You ever been in those caves, Mammoth Cave or something like that? And she says, this place has been like, you know when they flip the light, the flashlight on or the lighter that they have? And it doesn't matter where you are in that cave, as long as you're in the same vicinity, that light is, though small, real easy to see because of how dark. She says, man, it's been a dark place. And in this place, has shown me a light. This is what it is to be kingdom. If you missed the block party on Friday, sorry, right? You missed a good time. I mean, it was a party. It was a party right out here, right in our community, for everyone to enjoy. There was good music. There was lots of laughter. There was food and bounce houses. I chucked just a few kids on the side, on the bounce house. I think they walked out all right. But I don't know if you knew this, but our food truck that we got there was overwhelmed. They weren't prepared, really, for the number of orders and people and food that they had to make. And I know some of you out there had to wait 45, sometimes 50 minutes for their food. They told me privately that they had, at one point, 17 tickets behind that they hadn't got out yet. And you know what they said at the end of the night? I don't know why I'm getting choked up about stupid food. They said not one person complained. This is my favorite statistic of the whole night. See, the fruit of the Spirit is patience. And peace and joy. These are things that come from people who are in step with the Spirit. And these people who run that food truck saw a group of people who were patient, that didn't complain. Now, I saw somebody on the side muttering under your breath. Now, don't get too, you know, full of yourself here. But that guy and those people experienced a group of people who were patient. They were good news. Not only did they get to see it, they got to experience it. That's what representing the kingdom is like. It's flickering little lights in real dark places. When you discover who your king is, you follow his direction. You discover who you are and what you're meant to do, and moments like that, 3C, help represent to our kingdom, this kingdom in this world, good news. And we represent a good news king, and we are part of a good news kingdom, and we are supposed to be that good news where we live, work, and play. And I know we did it Friday night, at least for a couple people. I'm proud of you for that. I want to encourage you to do that. I want you to be motivated because you serve a good king and a good God who's here to restore good news. Thank you for representing him and representing him well. Keep it up. Let's pray. God, we're grateful. We're super grateful for your love and your goodness that we've heard so much about. And Lord, we need reminded, and we're grateful that you remind us in gentle ways that you are the king and we are not. And so God, may we recognize who you are, and in so doing, see who we and discover who we are and who we are called to be. God, it's an honor to know you and to have the secret of the kingdom given to us. May we not just operate unappreciative of that. May we, because of it, be good news. Because you are our King. And this is how you've directed your kingdom. Thank you for being such good news to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried too high. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Have a great day and happy Father's Day to everybody out there.